आपकी मर्जी,
मैं करा दूं।
जो भी हो। मैं आपको
यस सर, स्टार्ट।
नमस्कार, माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर प्रमोद कुमार गुप्ता। आई एम फाउंडर ऑफ इंडियन टीचर एजुकेशन कम्युनिटी। वी हैव ऑर्गेनाइज्ड ए प्रोग्राम ऑन बेसिक्स ऑफ एजुकेशन, बेसिक्स ऑफ रिसर्च विद कोलैबोरेशन ऑफ रोजरी कॉलेज ऑफ कॉमर्स एंड आर्ट्स, नोवेलिम, गोवा। एंड आई एम इन्वाइटिंग डॉक्टर लोबो फॉर फर्दर प्रोसीडिंग।
Thank you very much, sir, for collaborating with our college to organize this national webinar on research. And we are thankful to you. I will not take much time. I request our acting principal, Associate Professor Helik Barreto, to welcome. And please, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Francis. Good evening, everyone. Dr. D.N. Sensaswal, resource person for this faculty development program. Dr. Pramod Kumar Gupta, Indian Teachers Education in charge. Professors, research scholars, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to welcome you all for this 16 days online faculty development program on basis of research organized by Indian Teacher Education Community in collaboration with Rosary College of Commerce and Arts, Navelli. First of all, I welcome Dr. Sensaswal, former head and dean, SOE DAVV, Indore, Madhya Pradesh. And I also thank him for accepting our invitation to conduct this book, this FDP. I also thank Dr. Pramod Kumar Gupta for all his assistance in organizing this FDP. Dr. Sensaswal has rich experience in conducting programs. In fact, he has conducted over 500 faculty development programs and workshops across India. He has taught in the most reputed institutions of our country and has published over 140 research papers in reputed journals. I'm sure this faculty development program will benefit research scholars, students, and all those who are doing research. Rosary College is the largest college in South Goa in terms of students' enrollment and affiliated to Goa University. Recently, our college was re-accredited by NEC with A grade, with a CGPA score of 3.29 on a 4-point scale. We are offering a number of graduation courses, one post-graduation course in commerce, and PhD in commerce. Rosary College gives utmost importance to research every year. We have been motivating our teachers to take up research projects. We encourage our teachers and students to do quality research and publish their findings in the best national and international journals. However, to do quality research in any subject, the researchers must do in-depth literature review, identify the research gaps, use appropriate research methodology, consider sufficient sample size, make use of suitable statistical tools to test the hypothesis, and report their findings systematically. I'm sure this faculty development program will help researchers to understand the above concepts in research and will motivate them to do quality research in future. Finally, I thank Dr. Francis Lobo, a college director of physical education, for taking the initiative to organize this workshop. Yeah, thank you very much. I'm handing it over to now Dr. Sensaswal, the resource person, to conduct the workshop. Dr. Sensaswal, you can take over. Sir. Yeah.
Many, many thanks to you, sir. Many, many thanks to Lobo, sir. And now I am inviting Dr. T.N. Sensaswal, sir, for today's program. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. Let me at the outset express my gratitude to the director and the organizer of this particular program, who has given me the opportunity to help some of you. I don't know whether I will be able to help everybody or not. I will try to help everyone, but at least some of them ultimately will be helped automatically because of their own characteristics, own efforts which they make. Dear friends, let me at the outset tell you that if you have to ask question, so you can type your question in the chat box, or you even can unmute yourself. I do not know whether you are allowed or not. You can unmute yourself and you can ask me the question. I will try to reply you the question. If I fail to reply, then I will try to tell you the answer the next day. If it is 99%, I will tell you immediately. But if I am unable, then I will definitely tell you the next day. My dear friends, let us start. So I will like to start from the beginning, that let us see what exactly is a research. Now, if you see this word, it comprises of two words. One is re, other is search. Now you understand the meaning of it. You know, what do we search? Or why do we search? Or when do we search? Whenever we are in need of something and I'm not finding it, then I'm trying to search it. Okay. And if I have found, then fine. If I'm satisfied, fine. Otherwise, try to search again. So research means that somebody has got the solution of a problem, and you may not be fully aware of the solution. You may not agree with it. The solution may not help you. Then you may like to find out a better solution of the same problem. When you are searching, if you have not lost anything, you will not search. So searching involves there has to be some problem. And if you are not encountered with a problem, then the process of searching will not happen. So if there is a problem, then there has to be a solution. Now I like to ask, if there is one problem, do you think there is one and only one solution of the problem? Or can there be many solutions of the same problem? What do you think? You can write your answer in the chat box. Okay. Yes.
We have unmuted from our side. If anyone want to say something, then they can do it.
Omveer ji, namaskar. Omveer yahan pe aage hain bhaiya. So therefore, but let me now ask another question. You have taken one problem for the research and you complete your all the steps of the research. Now at the end, if you have taken only one problem and you complete your research, so at the end, will you come across only one solution of the problem in one research, or you will come across multiple solutions of the problem in one result. What do you think? No, thinks once again. Please see what I am asking. I take only one problem and I complete my research. So at the end, will I get only one solution or will I get multiple solutions? So far, I have got the answer. That's not the appropriate answer. Any other participant like to answer? Okay. Now, dear friends, yes, Smita, your answer is correct. Mehndi, Madi, your answer is correct. Both of you have given the correct answer. My dear friend, if you have one problem and if you complete your research, at the end, you will only come across one solution. In one research, when you take one problem, you cannot come across more, or you cannot get more than one solution in one research. This point must be very clear to all of you. I repeat, for the benefit of the participants, that when you place take care of your child. Someone is writing on my screen. I request the organizers, please, please, please see that if your child is around you, he or she should not touch the screen. Because I'm getting scratch on my. So that's not appropriate, dear friends. Dr. Pramod Kumar, please ask the organizer. So if you have one problem, so in one research, you come across only one and only one solution. If you take that problem again, and I'm going to close if you keep on touching my screen, I will discontinue the program.
Whoever is there, please see that you don't do that.
Now, please, organizers, you have to take care.
Sir, wait for a minute. We are looking into it. So wait for a minute. We are looking into it. We'll rectify it as soon as possible.
Because otherwise, I'm not a person. I will say bye-bye to you. And I'm not interested in conducting this program. You have to act as a...
We are looking into it. Just a moment.
Not irresponsible participants. So please take care from your side. Otherwise, rest assured, I will discontinue the program and I will not do it. Let organizers do whatever they want to do it. Dr. MD, who is Dr. MD? So should I continue or should I discontinue?
Sir, we are looking into it. Just a moment, 2-3 minutes. Sir, it will get rectified. We are changing some settings.
Anyway, you do best from your side. Today I am continuing and then let us see what happens. So if you take the same problem again and complete your process, at the end you may get the same solution or you may get a different solution of the same problem. And you know that when people have fever, then there are many medicines available. Some medicine will suit to someone and some medicine will suit to someone else. So when you have a problem and you want to reach to the solution, then you have to do activities. Without doing activities, you will not be able to arrive at the solution. And whenever you are doing different activities, then these activities have to be done in a particular sequence, in a particular order, by following particular steps. And when I use these word order, steps, etc., then it is systematic. So you have to carry out different activities systematically, or you can say scientifically. And when I say activities, you know, when you are brushing your teeth in the morning, so you know how many activities you have to do. You have to get up, go to the bathroom, take your brush, wash it, take paste, put it on it, take it in your mouth, move here, there. See, so many activities you have to do. And these activities you have to do in a particular sequence. It is not possible to reverse the sequence. You cannot brush your teeth without putting the paste on the brush. So everything is in a particular sequence. And whenever you do different activities in a particular order, and then that is called a process. So when you take your bath, taking bath is a process. When you are preparing coffee, preparing coffee is a process. When you cook, cooking is a process. When you take bath, taking bath is a process. So I hope you have understood. Now these are the five important words. Each word is important as far as the research is concerned, because without problem, research is not possible. Without doing activities, cannot arrive at a solution. And you have to do the activities in a particular order. So it's done systematically and process, and therefore. Now, if I have to define research, I must use these five words in the definition of the research. So therefore, we can say that research refers to a process. Research refers to a process wherein activities are carried out. Either you can use the word systematic or you can use the word scientific. Normally, people from science subjects, they use the word scientifically, and people from social science, and they use the word systematically. So therefore, one can say carried out scientifically to find solution of the problem. Please see here the five words, they are here. This is the word which is process. Another word is activities. Another word is scientific. Another word is solution, and another word is problem. And please understand, here I have written the problem because you have a particular problem, but I have not written the solution, because one problem can have more than one solution, and that you know it. So this is the general definition of the research. If I want to define research in commerce, then I will change this definition. And let me tell you now, how can I write the definition research in commerce? Research in commerce refers to a process wherein activities are carried out scientifically to find solution of the problem related to some aspect of commerce. Now then, this becomes the definition of research in commerce. If you want the definition of research in physical education, then it's very simple. Now you say research in physical education refers to a process wherein activities are carried out scientifically to find solution of the problem related to some aspect of physical education. So whatever is the subject in which you want to carry out the research, you have to take problem related to some aspect of that subject. This is important. So I have given you a general definition, and I have given you a specific definition. Now you can define research in any subject you like. Research in computer science refers to a process wherein activities are carried out scientifically to find solution of the problem related to some aspect of computer science. So whatever is the subject, if you want in psychology, then research in psychology refers. So I can say research in psychology refers to a process. Research in psychology refers to a process wherein activities are carried out scientifically to find solution of the problem related to some aspect of psychology. In psychology, you have many aspects, so therefore it may be from any aspect, whether whatever it is. If you want home science, then research in home science refers to a process wherein activities are carried out scientifically to find solution of the problem related to some aspect of home science. If it is food and nutrition, then some aspect of the food and nutrition. If it is child development, some aspect of the child development. So I hope my participants have understood that how a general definition can be modified so as to suit to your subject. Now let me tell you the characteristics. And when I'm telling you the characteristics, these are the five words which I'm now going to use it. So therefore the characteristics are these are the characteristics of research. Whenever you conduct the research, these characteristics will be there. Whether you conduct research in languages or conduct research in social sciences or in sciences or management or medical or agriculture, whatever is this, the characteristics will not change because these are not the characteristics of research in psychology. These are the general characteristics. So one characteristic is that research refers to a problem, or research involves problem, whatever you like. Research involves problem. That is the one characteristic. So I have used the word problem. Next is research is carried out through activities. Without activities, you cannot. Another is research is systematic in nature. It's systematic or scientific in nature. Then the fourth is research then research is a process. And another is research leads to solution. Now, these are the five characteristics of the research. And these five words are essential words. I'm sure you know the meaning of essential characteristic. Essential means without that, the definition of that word is incomplete or is not appropriate. You know it, that when people define noun in the books, the definition is the name of person, place, or thing is called noun. But the real definition of noun is name is noun, or naming words are noun. Whether it may be name of a person or name of a place or name of a thing or name of anything. Important is it must be name. So name is noun. If you give this definition to the student, he will never forget. And you need not to give him the different examples of noun. He can give you the examples of noun from day to day. You know, activities, whatever he does. So therefore, the essential characteristics is important. If your students understand the essential characteristics, they will not forget that concept. They will not memorize the definition of the concept. They can define any moment they like. So this is what I have now told you. Now, I want to ask you a question. And the question is very simple, because research involves scientific activity. So what is a scientific activity? What is scientific activities? Can any one of you like to answer by putting it in your chat box, the answer? That why do we say scientific activity? Why can't we say just activity? No, Shukla, no. You can replicate even unscientific activity, no problem at all. No. Why scientific? Or why systematic? That is important. No. Okay, any other one like to try? No. Manoj Kumar, you see your answer, and if you can word it in different words, maybe you may get a correct answer, otherwise it is not. No. Whatever answers I have got, not even single answer is correct. So please try to find out the correct answer of this particular question. And if you fail to find out the correct answer, I will give you the answer. But first, you should find out the answer. Okay, thank you very much. I am closing it because somebody is again playing. So I don't want to continue. So this program, I am discontinuing it. Dr. Sharma, again somebody is playing with my screen.
Sir, I have blocked the settings.
No, why? What is this? Now again they are is a mark.
Sir, kindly ignore this today. From tomorrow, we won't allow it from the beginning only. This is some technical issue and...
No, but
the one line which was earlier got deleted now.
No, earlier also is also there. The one, both the...
Yes.
Both the marks are there on...
Yes.
And if people...
Sir, kindly ignore this today, please. From tomorrow, from the beginning only, we won't allow anybody else to write on the screen.
This is too bad a one. I really do not understand why people do not respect the independence, the freedom of the other people to learn.
Sir, this is purely unprofessional and I accept it. But from technical point of view, I have changed the settings, but I don't know. Why is it happening? From tomorrow, we won't allow it to happen, please.
I think from tomorrow, you see that no one is able to access my screen.
Sure, sir, sure.
Thank you very much. I will continue today with half heart, not full heart.
Thank you so much for your patience, sir.
But that's not fair. The people should appreciate, should understand. And I don't know who is that person. Even that person is not saying sorry or something like this.
Yes, sir. I mean, only he can delete it, I think.
Anyway, that's okay. No, Praveen, that answer is not all right. Sonu, answer is not. Okay, dear participant, please respect the professor. Who will listen soon? Anyway, let us see. So you should try to answer this particular question. Now there is another, there are two words. What are the differences between discovery and invention? Because these are the two words appear quite often and people do ask question at least at the time of interview. So any one of you like to answer the difference between discovery and invention? So you can write your answer in the chat box. I will see it. Huh? Shani, your answer is only one part. Very good. What is the other difference? Omvir, your answer is quite all right. Deepa, okay. Deepa, your answer, but it's not complete. Manoj, no, okay. You have given one difference, and one difference is that discovery has to be of those things which exist on this particular planet. Anything which does not exist on the planet, it cannot come under discovery. So discovery only existing things. An invention, something new, is developed by doing some activities. So this is the one difference between discovery and invention, but this is not the complete difference. So please try to find out the other differences between discovery and invention. And you can see any book you like, you can see any website you like, you can ask any person you like, no restriction. But try to come up with the answer so you start understanding. Let us proceed. Now you know that there are different types of researches. And the types of researches, I don't know whether you people know or not, but let me now tell you. That one, I will say the serial number, then I will say the type of research, and then I will say the base. That why these are the types. Let me see, someone is writing. So let me see what is the answer that is coming. Okay, Praveen, thanks once again. This okay, what you have written is all right, but thanks further. So now I'm going to tell you the types of researches, and that I will tell you, I will put the here one type, another type, and another type. And you know, okay, Deepa Nigam, what else? What is the other one? Yes, yes, but that's not all. Let us see. You know, yes, okay. But it's not complete. You are just saying one. Now you learn. You know, whenever you have information or you have the data, how many types of information or how many types of data? Let us see what is the answer. Types of data. Or the information. How many types of information or how many types of data you have? Omvir, your answer is 100% correct. I'm sure your answer is not all right. It's not a primary data, it's not a secondary data. Primary is a source, secondary is a source. And Mohit, it's not discrete and continuous, yes. But when you are saying discrete and continuous, that's fine. But okay, so you are Praveen, your answer is correct. Shukla, your answer is not correct. Primary, secondary, tertiary, these are not the data, these are the sources. So my dear friends, you should try to differentiate between the types of data and the sources of data. The sources may be primary, may be secondary, may be tertiary, it's a different issue. But your information will always be either in quality or it may be quantitative. So information cannot be of the third type. See, in languages, you have pure qualitative information. In mathematics, you have qualitative information as well as quantitative information. In science, you have qualitative information as well as quantitative information. When you have the theory gives you the qualitative information. When you have a formula, okay, the formula is also a qualitative one because you are using symbols. But when you do a numerical problem, so that will have a qualitative information as well as quantitative information. When someone asks your name, it is a qualitative information. When someone asks your age, it is a quantitative information. So therefore, there are two types of data, the qualitative data and quantitative data. If your research involves qualitative information, then it is called qualitative research. So it is two, one is the qualitative research. And another one is called the quantitative research. And when you say the qualitative research and quantitative research, the base is type of data, or you can say type of information. Or if you like, you may say nature of data or nature of information. Or you may say nature of data or information. So see, if this is your base, then you should always say that research is either qualitative research or quantitative research. My dear friends, you know that in the examination, the student writes, there is a question, and student writes the answer. The question is qualitative in nature, and answer is also qualitative in nature. But the examiner, after reading the answer of the question, he may give 6 marks out of 10. So the examiner is converting a qualitative information into quantitative information. I repeat, here the examiner has converted the qualitative information into quantitative information. But if you ask the same examiner that can you reproduce the same answer of the question in which you have given 6 marks, I am sure they will not be able to do it. So when you convert a qualitative information into quantitative, from quantitative, you cannot go back, you cannot get your original quality. So there is a loss of information. And because of this loss, it is not advisable that you should convert a qualitative information into quantitative. You should not. This is important. So therefore, if your base is the type of data, then you have only 2 types of researches. They are qualitative research and quantitative research. And these 2 types of researches are in all subjects. In some subjects, it is only qualitative. In some subjects, it is qualitative and quantitative. Even in languages, if you have Hindi, it is qualitative. But if you have linguistic, it is quantitative. In history, it is majority information is qualitative, but there may be some quantity also. So therefore, these are the 2 types of the researches, and the base is type of data or nature of information. You can classify researches by using any other base. So let me have another criteria to classify the researches. If I say, if you have to study the vision of any person, each one of you have the vision for your own life. You know what you want to become. If you do not have a vision, you cannot achieve it. Each political party has a manifesto. And what is manifesto? Manifesto indicates that if we come to the power, then we will do this, this, this for the society. And that is the meaning of the, so that means they know. They tell their vision to the people through manifesto. Now, you know, Mahatma Gandhi had an idea about India. And what is that? That we must have freedom. If that idea would not have come into the mind of Mahatma Gandhi, I do not know what would have been the position today. So that the vision of the Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi had a vision for India with respect to the education, that what type of education should be there for the children of this particular country. So that is the vision. Rabindranath Tagore had his own vision, and depending upon that vision, he has written so much. Anyone who has a vision will definitely put it across to the people through the writing. You know Munshi Premchand. Munshi Premchand has written so much about the villages. So whatever he thought, whatever he understood, that he tried his level best to put across to the people through his own writings. And whenever you try to understand the vision, that means it is philosophy. It is philosophical research. Now, if you want to study the past event, whatever has happened, if you want to study that, I'm sure you know it, it is called history. It is called historical research. And historical research will refer to the past events. If you want to study what was the education system in India during British period, then it is not the philosophical type of research, but it has to be a historical type of research, because the event has already taken place. Until and unless event does not take place, it doesn't become a history. Now, pandemic came somewhere March 2020. Now, if you want to study how people were behaving during that particular period, then it becomes a historical thing, because the event has already passed. That may be old or that may be a recent one, is a different issue, but that's what becomes the historical research. Another is, if you want to study something in the present context, if you want to study in the present context, then I'm sure you know it is called survey research. You know, whenever you want to purchase a car, whatever the city in which you are and whatever are the car vendors in that particular city, you may go from one vendor to another vendor to another vendor. This is what is called survey. You want to find out and you want to see. If you want to rent a house in a particular colony of a particular place, you see many houses. And when you are seeing many houses, you are doing the survey. You try to find out what all facilities are available, whether electricity is 24 hours, water is 24 hours, the security is proper, and so on and so forth. So therefore, you do a lot of survey. When people, young couple, when they want their child to be admitted in some school. So they try to go from one school to another school and try to find out that what all facilities are available and what is the procedure of admission and how many seats and things of that variety. So therefore, that is what you do, survey. So many, there are many researches which are of survey type of researches. And these are, one is called exploratory research. Exploratory. Exploratory survey. You know, ONGC, Oil and Natural Gas Commission, they keep on doing exploratory survey to find out where the gas is available or not, where petrol is available or not. Those people who study geology, not geology, geology. Geology people conduct research and they normally do exploratory study. They try to explore what all types of minerals are available at different places. The another can be descriptive survey. The descriptive survey means where you try to describe. See, if you go to a place where you have never been before, suppose you have never come to Delhi and you come for the first time to Delhi. Now, when you go back to your place, the people will ask you about the Delhi and you will describe. And you will describe only and only if you have seen that particular place. If I have never gone to Goa and if I visit Goa after coming, my family members may ask about Goa. And then I have to describe that Goa people are like this, these facilities are available in the Goa beaches are neat and clean, the whole city is very peaceful, it's very safe. When I do like this, I am describing. So there is a descriptive survey. And descriptive survey research may be ethnography. See, you try to do describe some of the tribes. There are many tribes about which people may not know. There are many culture about which people do not know. And if you want to do a research or if you want to study the culture of a particular tribe, you have to become part and parcel of that tribe. And if you are not part and parcel, then my dear friend, you cannot describe, because description requires your first-hand experience. And the first-hand experience will always be when you are in that situation. When you stay with them, you do what they do, you eat what they eat, etc., etc. So ethnography researches will be descriptive. Another is a narrative. Narrative is again a descriptive. Another is phenomenology. So you may have the phenomenological research is again a descriptive research. Or there can be another, they call it a grounded. The name is grounded theory, but it's not basically a theory. But there is a way to describe. And for description, you get a lot of information using that. So through survey, you can explore, you can describe. Then another thing you can do is you can find out what they call it a correlation. Correlational survey. And my dear friend, this correlational survey means that you have the quantitative information, because all of you know correlation. There is a general word which is called relationship. Correlation and association are the technical words. So therefore, you have the correlational survey. And this correlational survey is pure quantitative in nature. Then there is another way of talking about the research. The D is when you want to do something which you can use for the future. Those researches whose finding will be used after the research has been completed. And I'm sure now you have a first-hand experience and you will be able to tell me the what type of the research can it be. I'm sure you'll say it is experimental research. You know, all over the world, the people are facing this COVID-19 problem. And large number of the scientists, they worked day and night, and now they have come up with the solution. And the solution which they have come up, it is only by conducting experimental study. Without experiment, they would not have come out, they would not have told that this may be of the solution of this particular pandemic. So the whatever the vaccine that is available for people to use, this vaccine is outcome of the experimental research. And the finding of the experiment can be used only and only once it has been completed. Then there is another thing. If you want to study something special, whenever you want to do this study of something special, then it has to be a case study. Case study research. You know, case study can be a method of teaching. In management, the people, they use case study as a method of teaching. But case study research can also be conducted. And case study research can be conducted only on those people, those countries, those places, those situations where there is something very, very, very particular, very peculiar, which is not the general Let me give you examples that you know. If there is a student, recently I read in the newspaper that there is one student who has got 6 gold medal in medical sciences, and this is the only student so far who has got so many gold medal. One gold medal people get, but so many gold medal, only one person. So such person is worth for the case study, because this person is something very, very unique. Let me give you another example. But when you do a case study, it may be case as a person, case may be a state as a case one, country as a case one. So when you say case, it has to be one, it has to be considered as one, only one, not in pieces. So you should study as one holistic. Now suppose if APJ Abdul Kalam would have been alive today, then somebody could have done the case study of APJ Abdul Kalam, because he had very, very different characteristics which were not found in those presidents who were before him and who were even after him. He had very peculiar characteristics. And I'm sure you know those peculiarity, I need not to tell you. So for case study, if there is a person who is either on the upper side or on the bottom side, if these extreme cases, they are worth for studying. If there is a student who has failed many a times in one class, then you can conduct the case study of such a student. You know that some time back, I read it in the newspaper that there is a brother and a sister in UP, and they have completed the class 12 when they were 10 years old. Normally class 12 means 16 years old or 17 years old. And the sister of that boy, she has completed her PhD when she was of 16 years old. Understand? So you, such people, you can catch hold and you can do the case study, because they are very, very special people. Try to see what are their, how do they prepare, how do they study, how they do this, and so many things are there you can study. So this is another way to classify the researches. If you see philosophical researches are 100% qualitative in nature. Historical researches are more qualitative, but some quantitative. The survey research is qualitative as well as quantitative. Experimental research is more quantitative, less qualitative. And case study is both qualitative and quantitative. So both these, they overlap. But if you say type of data is the base, then you type of research will be only qualitative research and quantitative research, nothing more than that. But if you say philosophical research, historical, survey, experimental, and case study, then you can differentiate them on the basis of methodology, or on the basis of steps followed. My dear friend, there are some steps which are common, but there is one step which is not there, say formulation of hypothesis, will not be in the philosophical type of research, will not be in the historical type of research, will not be in the qualitative research, will not be in the descriptive survey research. It's not possible. So the hypothesis will be only when you have a quantitative information. So you know this, how you can differentiate. There is another way to differentiate amongst the different types of research. So if you change the base, the type will change. And if type will change, the base will change. Another is called basic research, or is called fundamental research, or is called theoretical research. The another can be is called experimental research, or you can say applied research. And the third one is called action research. I hope all of you know what is a action research. And if you do not know, then let me tell you. Suppose I have a fever and my wife also has a fever. And my wife takes a medicine. Can I take the same medicine? I'm sure you will say no. Because she has got a fever, might be because of something else. I have got a fever, might be because of something else. So same medicine may not be appropriate for me. That is what is action research. Okay, so you have to understand the problem, the context, and then depending upon the context, you find a solution. Let me give you another example. If the Goa University students, they go on strike, and the registrar and vice chancellor, they talk to the student and they find a solution and strike is over. Now, Mumbai University students have gone on strike. Can the solution of Goa University be applied on Mumbai University? I'm sure you will say no, because Goa University students might have gone on strike because of some other problem, and Mumbai University students might have gone on strike because of some other problem. So when you find out the solution of the problem pertaining to that specific one, then this is called action research. If these are the three, your theoretical research is 100% qualitative in nature. Your experimental research is 100% quantitative in nature. And action research is also quantitative in nature. Yes, Seni, you can say that action research findings cannot be generalized. You are correct. So you will find that theoretical research is qualitative, experimental research is quantitative, and action research is quantitative. But can you think of what are the criteria on which we can differentiate among these three types of the researches, the theoretical research, the applied research, and the action research? Now, if you can think of that, then that is the base. So if that is the base, then you will use it is a theoretical research, experimental research, and action research. But if the base is nature of information, then you have to say qualitative research and quantitative research. So can any one of you think on what basis can we differentiate amongst the theoretical, experimental, and action research? Let us see what is the base that you are writing. Omvir, your answer is correct, Beta. Very good. Thank you very much. Your answer is 100% correct. Any other one like to tell? Any other participant like to tell? Think about it. So I have already given you the two questions, and this is the third question I am giving you. Try to find out the answers of these questions. And I once again tell you, there is no restriction. You can ask your teacher, you can see any book you like, you can see any website you like, you can talk to anyone on the earth, no problem at all. But try to find out the answers. And when you try to ask other people, then you start understanding that they do not know, so they and you both are same. Okay, so just try, let me see what the answer coming. The question is that if these are the three types of the researches, theoretical research, experimental research, and action research, then what is the base which we can use to differentiate among these three types of the researches? This is the question. And earlier two questions you have already noted down. So now let me proceed further. Now I have told you that research is a process. Since it is a process, so therefore, there must be steps. So let us see what are the steps of research. Can any one of you like to tell me what can be the first step of research? Omvir, your answer is 100% correct, Beta. No, Seni, no. Mohit, no. Think once again. Any other participant like to tell me what can be the first step of the research? No. Seni, no. Mithi, no. Manoj Kumar, okay. Not a complete one, but all right. Nigam, no. Sani no. Any other would like to answer? Shukla, okay, your answer, but it needs little modification. No, Sony, no. Let me tell you, the first step of the research is identification of problem. My dear friend, you know there is one more word which is called selection. Why selection of problem cannot be the first step? Why identification of problem is the first step? That means, what is the difference between identification and selection? And if you know the difference, then it's very good. And if you do not know the difference, then you must learn the difference between, because in many of the books, it is written that selection of problem is the first step. And that is technically incorrect statement, incorrect name of the first step. You cannot say selection of problem is the first step. You have to say identification of the problem is the first step. And there is a difference between identification and selection. So, do you know the difference, or should I tell you the difference? Do you know the difference, or should I tell you the difference? You are not writing, so that means you know the difference. Okay, then let me tell you. See, I'll take example that suppose you want to purchase fruits. So you go to the market, and normally you know the vendor from whom you purchase fruits. And if you have gone to a place which is new to you, then you will go to the market and try to find out what all types of fruits are available. And when you try to find out what all fruits are available, you will find that different fruits are available. So that means heterogeneous situation, because different fruits. Now, if you want to purchase apple, then you will see the all are apples. Now, if all apples are of the same size, of the same quality, then you will just pick up like this. And if all apples are not of the same size, are not of the same quality, then you will be selecting. So when the situation is a heterogeneous one, then you use the word identification. And when it becomes relatively homogeneous one, then you use the word selection. So identification, we always start with identification, and slowly, slowly, we try to narrow it down so that you are able to select. See, when you go to the market to purchase some utensil, so you go to a shop he will, suppose you want to purchase steel plates, dinner plates. So that shopkeeper will show you some dinner plates, steel dinner plates. You see, you may go to another nearby shop and again see, and maybe more shop, and then you will decide from which shop you want. So after having looked, then you try to reduce it and say that shop plate is better than this shop plate because you might have seen some quality of the material that is used. So whenever it is a broad one, then it is identification. When it becomes relatively homogeneous, then it is selection. I'll take example. Suppose you know there are subjects, Hindi, English, history, psychology, physical education, physics, chemistry, management, okay, sociology, education, okay, computer science, like this. There are varieties of subjects. So therefore, situation is a heterogeneous one. Now, what you do? Suppose you belong to education. So you say that you will like to take a problem related to some aspect of education. So what you have done, from so many subjects, you have selected the selection. And now it is so now you have education. So you have narrowed it down. Now in education, you know there is a philosophy of education, there is a economics of education, there is a history of education, there is a educational technology, there is a guidance and counsel, like this, there are many. Adult education, etc., higher education, etc. Now, if suppose you decide that now you want to do a research related to educational technology, so you are further narrowing it down. So now you have the educational technology. So therefore, you have taken out the educational technology and you have let guidance and counseling, economics, everything. Now, educational technology, you again have, say, micro teaching. Say you have models of teaching. You have information technology, information technology like this. Now, in this one, if you take now models of teaching, so if you take the models of teaching, now just see, so you, what are you doing? You are slowly, slowly narrowing it down. In the night, if there is no light, and if you have to find your path, you must have experienced that you have narrowed down your vision. The more narrow your vision is, the better the quality of the path that you see. So here, each researcher always start with broader things, and slowly, slowly, he tries to narrow it down. And in models of teaching, there is one called concept attainment model. Another is, say, inquiry training model. Another is advanced organizer model. Like this, there are many. And in this, if you want to do the research related to concept attainment one, then you select it like this. So my dear friend, each and every researcher always starts with a broader thing, and slowly, slowly, he has to narrow it down. Now, when it becomes so narrow that it cannot be further narrowed down, then you select. So selection is a part and parcel of the identification. I'm sure now you have understood the difference between identification and the selection. Now, another technical word here is problem. Can anyone tells me what is another word for a problem? Is there any other word for problem? Omvir, your answer is correct, beta. Very nice. Any other participant like to answer? No, Mohit, not research gap. No. When you say the problem, then what is the technical word? Any other participant like to tell me what is the word? Okay, let me give you a hint. The first letter is V. There is another word for the problem, and that word starts with the word V. Let us see who can tell me. Yes. Yes. Methi, you have got it correct. Shukla, you have got it correct. Smita, you have got it correct. Variable. Very good. So therefore, you have to select the variable. Now, in one research, minimum how many variables should be taken? You want to conduct a research, so what is the minimum number of the variable? Pre- Praveen, think once again. Omvir, your answer is correct. Deepa thinks once again. Manoj thinks once again. Mohit, your answer is correct. Mathi, your answer is correct. My dear friend, there must be minimum one variable, because without variable, it is not possible to carry out research. If you want to conduct a research, if you want to do research, you have to take minimum one variable. But if you want, you can take more variable. But whenever someone asks minimum how many variables should one take, then you should take it's always one. But if you want more than one, the answer is yes. So you have to select variable. Sometimes people use the word problem, but you can also use the word variable. Because if you have a body temperature, if your body temperature does not vary, then there is no problem. You have a blood pressure, if it does not vary, then you have no problem. So you know the temperature becomes a problem only and only if it changes, if it goes up or down. The blood pressure, you have a problem only if the blood pressure either increases or decreases. Weight. Weight can be a problem if it increases or if it decreases. So therefore, each problem is only because it is a variable. So if you want, you can use the word variable, or if you want, you can use the word problem, no problem at all. Now, once you have selected the variable, the next, you should be able to write title. And when you want to write title of the research, then it is important for you to understand, can the title be broad versus narrow versus specific. Can any one of you tell me that should the title be narrow, broad, narrow, or specific? Omvir, your answer is correct. Praveen thinks once again. Shukla thinks once again. Anshu thinks once again. Manoj thinks once again. Jyotika, your answer is all right, correct. Shukla, your answer is correct. Now it is correct. Yes, I will explain, but you should first try to answer. Then I will explain, no problem at all. I will give you examples, nothing to worry about it. This is the one important point that you should understand. Another point for the title you should understand is, when you read title of a research, I am not talking title of a book. I am not talking title of a paper. I am talking about title of a research. You know, the book title is very different from research paper title and from your research title. So therefore, I am now talking of when a title is to be written, then what all information must be given in the title. And if the title does not have those information, then the title is not appropriate title. Because many a times you might have read the title of the research, and after reading, you might have observed that this title is not complete, that it is incomplete. What is the meaning of incomplete? Incomplete means some information should have been given in the title, but that information is not available in the title. So as a researcher, you must know what all information, should be given in the title. And my dear friend, it is unfortunate that each researcher has to write the title, but teacher never teach how to write the title. And it is because of that, the quality of research in India is very weak. But I will tell you how to write a title. So therefore, if you attend it properly, you will know many of the things which are not given in the books, and teachers do not give you this information. So therefore, this is the another thing. The third thing is that when you are writing a title, can title start with word two? All of you know that when you are writing objective, objective always start with the word two. But can title start with the word two? I will tell you why. Another is, can there be a full stop at the end of the title? I'm sure you know it, but still I will like to tell you, because I have found many researchers, they put full stop at the end of the title. And when I point out, then they say it is by mistake. So please, you have to be careful to reduce your mistakes. Okay? Now, these are the two things. And the third thing under the identification is, as a researcher, once you have selected the variable, you have written your title. Next is, you have to write your objective. Each research must have minimum one objective. But if you want, you can have more than one objective. Absolutely no problem. If you do not want to write the caption heading as objective, you can write it as a research question. But in one research, either you should write a caption as objective or you write a caption as a research question. In one research, you should not write both because both are having the same meaning. No, I will tell you, Sani, I will tell you, hold on your question. So therefore, important is that when you are writing the heading as objective, you should write it in a simple sentence. But if you are writing the heading as research question, the same simple sentence, you can write it in the question form. I will give you the example, but in one research, you should not write both the objectives as well as research questions. Now, these days, I have come across many PhD theses where the researcher has written objective as well as research question. That is technically incorrect. And this happens because the researchers do not understand the difference between objective and the research question. If some of the teachers are attending this webinar, then I like to tell you, when you apply for major research project or minor research project to the UGC or to ICSSR or to CSIR or to DST, etc., they have a pro forma. And in the pro forma, it is written objective slash research question. That means either you write objective or you write research question, you need not to write both. So as a researcher, you now have to understand that when you are writing either the objective or research question, should they be broad versus narrow versus pinpoint. That is the decision you as a researcher have to take. Then another is that either you write sentence form or you write question form. That's your choice. So in step number one, if as a researcher, you have selected your variable, you have written the title and you have written the objective, then your step number one is over. But I just like to ask you that as a researcher, should you first select the variable, then write the title, and then write the objective? Or first you should write a title, then think of a variable, and then write objective? Or first you write a title, then write objective, then think of the variable? Or first you write objective, then write title, then think of the variable? So what must be the sequence amongst variable, title, and objectives? So any participant like to answer this question? Shukla thinks once again. Sani thinks once again. Nigam, think. Gautam thinks once again. Omvir, your answer is correct. Jamal, your answer is not all right, beta. Praveen thinks once again. Please understand. See, if you write your title first and after that you decide your variable, then it means you cannot write mentioned variable in the title because you have not decided the variable. And you know you cannot have a title without a variable. So therefore, important is before you write your title, you must select a variable. So as a researcher, you have to select variable first. And after that, then you have to think whether it is a title or it is an objective. Now you know that for one particular title, you can have many objectives. And if your title is specific, then you cannot have many objectives. So your title must be narrow. And you might have seen that for one particular title, a researcher might have written 4 objectives or 10 objectives or 20 objectives. I have seen one thesis where for one title, the researcher has written 45 objectives. So therefore, because your title is narrow and your objectives are pinpointed, then because of the narrowness of your title, for one title, you can write many objectives. So the sequence is, as a researcher, you have to first select the variable, then you must write the title, and then you should write the objectives. And if you do not follow this particular sequence, then it is not correct. So if, as a researcher, you have selected the variable, you have written the title, and you have written the objectives, your step number one is over. Then we go to the step number two. Can any one of you tell me what is the step number two? Step number two. No, Praveen, no, this is not okay. Sani, no, okay. Omvir, 100% your answer is correct. Manoj, your answer is correct. Any other participant like to give answer? Praveen thinks once again. Now, my dear friend, in the step number one, your last was objectives. And yes, Jamal, your answer is correct, beta. So last one was your objective or the research question. If that is the last one, then you can think of what might be the solution of the problem. And therefore, another, the second step is formulation of hypothesis. Let me tell you what exactly is a hypothesis. I'm sure you know, hypothesis is the tentative solution of the problem. Another definition is hypothesis is the intelligent guess about the solutions of the problem. And the third definition is hypothesis is the conjectural statement about the relationship between variables. These are the three definitions of the hypothesis. See, hypothesis is a tentative solution. It is not the final solution. Hypothesis is the intelligent guess. It is not the guess. And I'm sure you know the difference between intelligent guess and the difference between guess. And you know that hypothesis is the conjectural statement. It is again a guess. Now you know that suppose you go home and you find there is no lock on the door. As soon as you see there is no lock, then immediately the idea starts coming to your mind that somebody might have come, or it might be you did not lock, or it might be some other person has come, he has broken the lock. All these are the tentative solution of this particular situation. You know that when you were student, during examination, you used to take last 5-6 years question paper and used to analyze to find out the possibility of the question, that from which portion of the syllabus, which question is likely to come. Now, if the last year papers would not have been available, then you would not have been able to find out or to guess which of the questions will come. That is what is intelligent guess. Okay. Now, so that means when you go to the doctor or I go to the doctor examines me. And after examining, the doctor may suggest me that I should go to pathology lab and I should get these tests done. Why doctor wants me to get some of the tests from the pathology lab? Because after examining, he might have thought that suffering from this particular disease, and he wants to confirm that yes, he is suffering from that particular disease. So that is what is your intelligent guess. Okay, so therefore, if because hypothesis is not the final solution, it is a tentative solution, and therefore it has to be tested. And when you want to test the hypothesis in science, people do testing in the laboratory. As just now I said, I went to the pathology lab to get some of the tests done. but the social science people do not have the lab. So they do the testing of the hypothesis by collecting the data from the field and analyzing the data with the help of statistical technique. And if you want to analyze data with the help of statistical technique, you must have quantitative data. If you do not have quantitative data, then you cannot analyze it with the help of a statistical techniques. I will tell you, just now I am telling you. So please understand, if you have a research where you have a qualitative data, then you can analyze with the help of a statistical technique, and then you can test the hypothesis, then you should formulate a hypothesis. I repeat, if you can collect the quantitative data, which can be analyzed with the help of a statistical technique, then you can test the hypothesis, and then you must formulate the hypothesis. But if you conduct a research where you have a qualitative data which cannot be analyzed with the help of a statistical technique, then you cannot test the hypothesis, then you should not formulate the hypothesis. So formulation of hypothesis will not be the step in philosophical research, in qualitative research, in historical research, in descriptive survey research, in case study research. In so many types of the researches, the formulation of hypothesis will not be the step. So formulation of hypothesis is a tentative step only for the experimental study as well as a correlational study. You must have formulation of the hypothesis. Otherwise, you need not to have formulation of hypothesis. So in all researches, formulation of hypothesis may not be there. But if you have collected a qualitative data which can be converted into quantitative and which can be analyzed with the help of a statistical technique, then you can test the hypothesis, then you must formulate the hypothesis. And in many of the researches, people collect qualitative data and they convert it into quantitative in order to analyze it with the help of a statistical technique. And then they have to formulate hypothesis because you can test the hypothesis. So I stop it today here because I have another webinar. So I switch over to another webinar. So thank you very much. And please, 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 I request you, if anyone is doing that type of thing, so which leaves a mark on my page, please do not do it.
Thank you so much, sir, for today's session. So thank you for your patience. And with these words, I would like to end this class today. Thank you so much.